I got a question for you. How do you get a farm girl to find you or to like you? You got a tractor. You got a tractor, okay? You got to have a tractor, all right? Hey, I'll try it on that one. I laughed at that one. I thought that was a good one. Hey, if you're visiting with us this morning, we appreciate your visit, and we want you to fill out one of those visitor cards and put it in the offering plate when it comes by. And not only that, but just to let you know how much we appreciate you in the Welcome Center, we have a little gift for you. So just come by and tell them you're a visitor, and we'll have the gift for you there. I want to thank you for worshiping with us this morning. Let me pray for us as we begin. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for everyone that is here to worship with us, Lord. And we pray, God, that your Holy Spirit would touch their life. And, Lord, reveal your will for them, God. Maybe there's someone here that's hurting. God, we pray that you would bring the healing. Lord, we pray for anyone here that's going through a season of uncertainty. Lord, we pray that you give them direction. And, Lord, we just pray that we would give you our full attention now as we worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The announcement did say that it reminded you that we will be collecting our Lottie Moon Christmas offering beginning next week. Forest Home has been known around the state as a great church that supports missions and so forth. So we encourage you to be prepared to give to that. The church goal is $10,500, and I know we can reach that goal. And because as we looked at that, one of the things that Southern Baptists are so good at is reaching out to the world. It's hymn number 364. Let's sing together. We have heard the Macedonian call today to send the light.
There's a call comes ringing o'er the restless way to send the light. Send the light, oh, send the light, send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore. He is Lord, He is Lord. Risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Would you stand, please? He is Lord. Lord, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
We'll have our prayer for our offering now.
Heavenly Father, just so grateful that we're able to assemble together here today in peace and And Lord, that you're in control of this world, and even though it doesn't look like it sometimes. And Lord, we just lift up all these tithes and offerings to you and ask that you'd bless them and multiply them for your glory and for your honor. And we just thank you for Jesus and what he means to us. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you, James. The book of the Revelation, chapter 21, beloved John writes, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. But I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. And the city had no need of the sun or of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God illuminated it, and the Lamb is its light."
Thank you. Have your Bibles, turn with me to Luke chapter 17, throw you a little curveball this morning. Luke chapter 17. Some of you were cheating. You got caught. Luke 17. Y'all ready for Thanksgiving? Some of you are. You ladies are not because you got to cook it, right? So that's why you're not ready. Us guys are ready because we're ready to eat it. And I'm grateful for Thanksgiving. And it seemed like you got here in a hurry. All of a sudden it's here. And then next thing we know, Christmas will be here. And then the new year will be here. And then it'll be summer all over again, right? It's usually how it goes. Luke chapter 17, we'll look at verse 11 through verse 19. What I love about Thanksgiving is it truly is a time for us to remember not only to eat good food and turkey and ham and all dressing and all those other things, but it's also a time for us to really stop and really remember what we're thankful for. This morning, I want to pose a question for all of us. If the only things that you had today were the things that you told God you were thankful for yesterday, what would you have? So if the only things that you had today were the things that you thank God for yesterday, what would you have? Would you have your home? Would you have your family? Would you have your husband or your wife? And some of you today would probably say, "Woo, yeah, you can take him or take her," right? Your health, your family. Would you have your salvation? Now, I'm grateful God does not operate in that way, because most of us would be in deep trouble this morning. Because yesterday we didn't thank him for a whole lot. Or maybe you did. Maybe it was one of those days. Hey, I came out good today. But I'm glad God doesn't operate in that way. Because God is loving and God is merciful. And God still gives us the blessings that we fail to thank him for. Thank goodness, right? So this morning, today's passage kind of presents a real life incident from the life of Jesus Christ. It is a story that we find ourselves with 10 lepers who come to Jesus for healing. And their response, or their lack of response, to what Jesus has done for them. So this morning, I kind of want to just give you a broad idea of what it means, and through God's word and through God's teaching, how we should give thanks. Our response to all the things that God has done for us. So Luke chapter 17, stand with me as we read, because some of you look a little sleepy. Do we need to do some jumping jacks, squats, anything like that? Everybody good? Luke 17, verse 11. Look there with me and read along. It says, while Jesus was on the way to Jerusalem, he was passing between Samaria and Galilee. And he entered a village. 10 men with leprosy who stood at a distance met him. And they raised their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourself to the priest." And as they were going, they were cleansed. Now one of them, when he saw he had been healed, turned back, glorifying God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at his feet, giving thanks to him. And he was a Samaritan. But Jesus responded and said, "Were there not 10 of you that were clean? But the 9... where are they? Was no one found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Stand up and go. Your faith has made you well." Let's pray together. Father, this morning we simply come to say thanks. Thanks for your goodness. Thank you for your church. Thank you for your people. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to assemble together. God, to meet together. God, to come to hear your word. And God, I pray you speak to us through it. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Y'all can be seated, unless you want to stand the whole service. Now, we find Jesus here. The first thing we see in verses 11 through 13, we see this request of these lepers. So how many lepers do we have? We have 10 lepers. So Jesus here is on his way to Jerusalem. Jesus is traveling to Jerusalem. Jesus traveled along, the Bible tells us that Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. And he was going into this village. And these 10 men who had leprosy had met him there. The Bible says that they stood at a distance and they cried out with a loud voice, "Hey, Jesus, have mercy, have pity on us." Now, when you look at the wider context of why Jesus is traveling to Jerusalem, if you look back and you look at the previous chapters and verses, is that it's clear that Jesus is not only heading to Jerusalem, but he's on his way to the cross. So Jesus is traveling to Jerusalem. We know what's going to happen as he enters Jerusalem, right? Jesus is heading to Jerusalem, and Jesus probably has his mind, I would imagine, Jesus has his mind and is focused on the cross. Jesus knows what's about to take place just a few days later. And Jesus' journey to Jerusalem began back in Luke chapter 9. Luke tells us this: at this time, as the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus set out for Jerusalem. That's Luke chapter 9 and verse 51. Luke makes it clear that from this point on, Jesus is heading to Jerusalem with full knowledge of all that awaits him there. Jesus has knowledge of his suffering, of his crucifixion, of his death, his burial, and even his resurrection. And at this particular point in the journey of Jesus to Jerusalem, he is traveling along this border between Samaria and Galilee. Notice that Samaria is named or listed first. That's because Samaria will play an important role in the story to come. Luke is the only gospel writer that tells this particular story. Interesting, he is the only one to tell the story of the Good Samaritan as well, that you find in Luke chapter 10. And so as Jesus travels along this border, these 10 men with leprosy meet Jesus. Now, the word leprosy, it means a variety or a variation of skin diseases. So this may or may not be the same disease that we know as leprosy today. Either way, the disease of leprosy was an isolated or was chosen to isolate a person from society. It wasn't just because, it was because that's what the law required. It was an Old Testament law. If you had leprosy, if you had a skin disease, that the requirement was that you isolate yourself. You can find that in Leviticus chapter 13 and Numbers chapter 5. And God gave this command to his people, not only for health reasons, but as we will learn later in the Old Testament, it was also a picture of sin. Similar to leprosy in the physical world, that's what sin does to us. It isolates us. But you know the old saying, you find this Samaritan and you find these Jews, these men with leprosy. And the old saying goes that misery loves company. So these men who have leprosy, though they are isolated, though Samaritans and Jews didn't hang out with each other, but you find these men together. And Luke tells us that they stood at a distance and they called out to Jesus with a loud voice. We know from the Old Testament in 2 Kings chapter 7 that lepers traveled in groups. So if you had leprosy, you hung out with other people who had leprosy because you were isolated, and they particularly traveled in groups. And so obviously they have heard about Jesus. They have heard about Jesus' power and authority to heal. So Jesus gave these lepers hope. Jesus healing people of leprosy was something unprecedented. It didn't happen. In the Old Testament, we only find two people that had been healed of leprosy. Two people. If you go to Numbers chapter 12, if you go to 2 Kings chapter 5, in Numbers chapter 12, Moses' sister, Miriam, was healed directly by God in an answer to prayer. If you go to 2 Kings chapter 5, the Syrian commander, Naaman, was healed after humbly seeking after God. So if you look at these 10 lepers, what do they call Jesus? What do they refer Jesus as? How do they address Jesus? They simply say, Master. They are recognizing Jesus' authority over them. They recognize him as the master of their faith. What was going to happen to them solely depended upon Jesus. Look at verse 14. So we find these lepers calling out to Jesus, and we find the result of these lepers calling out to Jesus. Am I the only one ringing? Y'all hear me ringing? Okay. Just making sure I wasn't losing my mind. Look at verse 14. We find what happens when they call out to Jesus. It says, when Jesus saw them, he said, go show yourself to the priest. And as they went, they were healed. They were cleansed. Notice Jesus doesn't answer their request or their prayer right away. He says, first, go show yourself to the priest. Did you know that was also a requirement by Old Testament law? Before, the person who was with this disease could go back into society, they had to go to the priest. They had to be declared clean by the priest. They had to offer sacrifices. They had to undergo certain rituals in order to be put back into society. So Jesus says, hey, go show yourself to the priest. If you look at Luke chapter 5, there's another story of healing of a man with leprosy. Jesus here in Luke chapter 5 heals the man first and then tells him to go to the priest. Here in Luke 17, we find Jesus first saying, go to the priest. First, go to the priest, and then the Bible says, as they were going, what happened? They were healed. Luke goes on to tell us, as they went, they were made clean. Now, understand this, the Samaritan and the Jew, okay, these are two separate people, two separate groups of people who didn't like each other. And so they would have had different priests. So they probably went off in separate directions. To me, Jesus here, the most remarkable part of this story is that Jesus told them to go, and as they were going, they were healed. Here Jesus is showing his remarkable power. Because Jesus could have touched them, Jesus could have spoke over them, but Jesus says, go, and as they were going, they were healed. We also find the response of the Samaritan in verse 15 and 16. Look at verse 15 and 16. It says, one of them, when he saw that he was healed, he came back. He came back, and he was praising God in a loud voice. Now, Luke here tells us that one of these men came back. Remember how all of the lepers, all 10 of them, how did they make their vocal request known to Jesus? The Bible says they cried out in a loud voice. But we find this one leper. He returned to Jesus, and how did he respond? In a loud voice. As we read this, and as I highlight things for me personally, this question always comes to mind. Do you praise God loudly and with passion? How many of y'all screamed at the TV yesterday? Because I know you Texas A&M fans did. Didn't you? You screamed. I did. I don't know if I screamed, but I was very frustrated yesterday over football. Very frustrated, so y'all couldn't give me a hard time. Or don't give me a hard time. I wasn't in the place to give me a hard time yesterday. But as we become passionate about other things in our life, do we praise God with the same intensity, the same passion? Do we praise Him when He answers our prayers? Has God performed a miracle in your life? Has God done something that only God could do in your life? I know some of you, He probably has. Maybe He's healed a family member that the doctor said, hey, look, doesn't look too good. Do you praise God loudly and passionately? And here this one leper who returned throws himself at Jesus' feet. You know why? Because he's overcome with emotion. Did you know that emotion is a good thing? It's okay to have emotion. Did you know it's okay to have emotion in worship? It's okay to have emotion in thanking God for all the things that he's done for you. It's okay to be emotional. It's okay to be passionate. It's okay to be excited over the things that God has done in your life when we come to realize all that he has done. And here we find this leper who had no hope, isolated from society, and Jesus simply says, go show yourself to the priest. And as the Samaritan was going, he was healed. And the Bible says he turned around and he fell at the feet of Jesus. What a remarkable story. I would think the Jews in attendance who had saw this, had heard, would have been pretty mad because Jews didn't hang out with Samaritans. Look at verse 17 through 19. Look at the response of Jesus. And Jesus, as this Samaritan fell at the feet of Jesus, he began to thank him. And Jesus asked this question like Jesus don't already know the answer to the question. And he says, were not all 10 of you healed, cleansed? Where are the other 9 at? Where'd the other 9 go? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except who? This foreigner. Jesus asked three questions in response. He says, were not all 10 healed? The answer is what? Absolutely, yes. Luke tells us they went and all 10 were healed. Jesus also asked the second question. Where are the other 9? The implication here is that the other 9 should have returned, right? Apparently, they went to the priest at the temple, but they didn't come back to give thanks to God. The third question was, no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? The word foreigner is referring to non-Jews. This is the word that was used, okay, simply means to keep out. Stay away. Jews, non-Jews were not allowed in certain parts. Notice what is interesting. I love to read stuff and things just jump out. This word jumped out. It is the word found. It is the word found. Notice Jesus' use of the word found. Jesus asked, was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? Luke also tells us in Luke 19, this is interesting because this is the narration of Luke. This is how Luke responds. And he says this in Luke 19. He says, Luke tells us that Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. So it's significant here that Jesus speaks of the Samaritan leper who was healed, and he speaks of this leper as someone who is being found. The implication is that the other 9 was what? Not found. 1 was found and 9 was not. They all received healing. They all received blessings, but only 1 gave thanks. In Jesus' response, he says in verse 19 of Luke 17, he says, hey, get up off your feet. Get on your feet. Go. Your faith has made you well. Jesus is literally saying, your faith has saved you. All 10 lepers were clean in response to their faith. But here Jesus is meaning something a little deeper. The Samaritan leper not only experienced physical healing, but he also experienced spiritual healing. Why? Why did this leper, who was an outcast, experience not only physical healing, but spiritual healing? Because he was willing to give thanks. He was willing to worship. He was overcome with all of God's goodness in his life. This morning, when you think about the things that you have, sometimes we think more about the things that we don't have than the things that we have, right? When you start and you stop and you think about all the blessings that you have in your life, all of God's goodness upon your life, how do you respond? How do you respond? Do you say, God, thank you? God, I praise you. God, I'm grateful for how you've blessed me. So back to the original question. What if you only had today the things that you thank God for yesterday? What would you have? 10 lepers were cleansed. Only one returned to thank Jesus, and he was a Samaritan. This morning, let's be a people who are thankful. Let's be a people who are grateful that we're not complainers, we're not griping, we're not dissatisfied, but that we're people that, hey, look, we actually have a car. You may complain that your car don't run half the time, but at least you got one. You may complain that you don't always have the best things to eat, but guess what? You have something to eat. You may not have the name brand clothes, but you got clothes. You may not have the best shoes, but you've got shoes. This morning, we should be people who are grateful. This morning, are you grateful that God chose to save you? You're grateful that God chose to save you, that God raised you out in the depths of your sin. God raised you up, and God saved you. This morning, I'm grateful that God saved someone like me. God is continuing to bless someone like me. Let's be a church. Let's be a people. Then when we stop, we say, God, thank you. We fall at his feet and we say, thank you. This morning, will you thank him? Will you thank him for all that he's done in your life? Will you stop this morning and say, God, thank you? As we sing this morning, you're going to have that opportunity. However you want to do that, if you want to do it from your seat, if you want to come forward and say, God, and bow before him and say, God, thank you. This morning, there may be some of you here, there may be someone here that has never trusted in Christ. And maybe today you need to do that. Maybe you need to ask Christ to save you, to forgive you of your sins, come into your life and to be your Lord and Savior. Maybe there's someone here that has been saved but never fallen through with baptism, and you need to do that. I pray and trust that you'll do that this morning. Let's pray together as Brother Mark comes. Father, this morning we simply come to say thanks. Thank you, Lord, that you're good to us. Thank you, Lord, that in the midst of our sinfulness, in the midst of our own life, God, that you choose to still bless us even when we're not grateful. So this morning, I pray that we as a church are people who are thankful, people who are grateful for all that you've done and all that you have in store for us. And Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, I hope and pray that all of us here this morning have a relationship with you. And God, if there's someone here that doesn't, Lord, I pray that today they confess their sins, that they trust in you for salvation. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Would you stand with us as we sing?